ओके सो गुड इवनिंग एवरीवन, माय सेल्फ श्वेता गावकर, एग्रीकल्चर ग्रेजुएट, प्रेजेंटली वर्किंग एज अ टेक्निकल एडमिनिस्ट्रेशन इंचार्ज इन नानोस फर्म केवड़ा सांगेम गोवा. हैज एवरीवन नोज दैट बोटानिकल सोसाइटी ऑफ गोवा इन एसोसिएशन विथ एग्रीकॉस एलुमनी एसोसिएशन गोवा इज कंडक्टिंग फ्री ऑनलाइन वेबिनार ऑन एवरी संडे फ्रॉम पास्ट 9 मंथ्स ऑन डिफरेंट टॉपिक्स ऑफ एग्रीकल्चर. टुडेज टॉपिक इज ऑन मेडिसिनल प्लांट्स, पंचगव्या एंड फंगल डिजीज मैनेजमेंट. फर्स्ट आई वुड लाइक टू वेलकम सेशन कोऑर्डिनेटर मिस्टर मिगेल बगाइजा सर, एग्रीकल्चरल कंसल्टेंट एंड विजिटिंग प्रोफेसर ऑफ अर्बन गार्डनिंग एंड डेम्पे कॉलेज ऑफ आर्ट्स एंड साइंस पेंजिंग. एंड स्पीकर्स ऑफ टुडेज वेबिनार मिस्टर कुशल नाइक, मिसेस प्रियंका वंदित नाइक एंड मिस लीजा फिनेरो. सो अवर फर्स्ट स्पीकर मिस्टर कुशल नाइक, बीएससी एग्रीकल्चर ग्रेजुएट फ्रॉम डॉन बॉस्को कॉलेज ऑफ एग्रीकल्चर सुरगोना केपेम गोवा. ही इज अ कंसल्टेंट इन ऑयस्टर मशरूम फार्मिंग एंड प्लांट प्रोटेक्शन. करंटली ही इज वर्किंग इन प्लांट टिश्यू कल्चर लैब एज अ लैब टेक्नीशियन इन प्लांटिफाई लैबोरेटरी. So today he is going to cover on the topic medicinal plants around us. Yes, Kushal, you can start.
Mr. Reza, can this please put off your
18.
Yes.
Please put off your camera. Mrs. Candice?
Okay, thank you, Shweta, for the introduction. Let us start. So today's presentation will be quite different, and that is medicinal plants around us. What happens is that we don't realize there are some plants which possess some medicinal potential, and we discard them as a weeds, or we throw them without knowing their medicinal okay, next slide. A previous slide. Okay, thank you. Okay, so I want you all to understand that this video, information is for this. It is of is for information purpose only and doesn't constitute any kind of medical advice to anyone. One should not consume any herbal plant without proper knowledge or without discussing with a professional Ayurvedic doctor. This next slide. Okay, before going forward with our presentation, let us know some of the medical terms which we could come across. First is decoction. What is decoction? It is a concentrated water extraction of plant material made through boiling, or it is just like making a tea, but where you use a plant part in that boiling and then you filter it and you use it. The second is infusion. A drink, remedy, or an extract made by soaking the plant material in liquid. It is usually, most of the time, it will be a water. Now the laxative. Something that promotes emptying of the bowels. Laxatives are used to combat constipation. Now, dyspepsia. It is nothing but imperfect or painful digestion. The last is astringent. Astringent is any a group of substances that causes the contraction or shrinkage of tissue that dry up. Secretions. Next slide. Okay, so let me start. Bui aulo, or in English it's known as Chanka pidera, or its botanical name is Phyllanthus fraternus. You may see them or come across them on the roadside or in the wasteland or even in your garden also. If you look very closely, they are like just a miniature copy of aula. It is credited with hypoglycemic activity, means it is a potential to reduce sugar in blood level. So it is very good for diabetes. Its seeds and leaves decoction is also used for piles. And it is used as a tonic for a liver. Overall health of a liver, it makes better. And even its latex is used for offensive sores. Next is tulus, or holy basil we known as, and a botanical name is Osimum tenuflorum. Now it is a very common medicinal plant which we may come across. Now its leaf juice is effectively used for cough and respiratory tract disorder, and its seed decoction is found helpful in piles, are used to expel worms out of the body, and grounded fresh roots are next. Okay, people know this as also Brahmi, but it is known as Gunduri. In English, it is known as Asiatic pennywort, and botanical name is Centella asiatica. Again, people consider it as a weed, not knowing its medicinal potential, and it is thrown away. Now, its powdered dry leaves is known very useful for tuberculosis. Plant juice is applied externally for abdominal swelling and inflammation. Plant decoction is found helpful in asthma, cough, and even bronchitis. Next. Okay. This is very common in our garden, anywhere in our nurse. This is known as panfuti or miracle leaf. This leaf juice is used in treating cough, fever, and cold. It is used for ear pain, kidney, and gallbladder stones. Root is used to treat high blood pressure and diabetes. Next, sadafuli, we can call that periwinkle. We know this plant as it is an ornamental plant, but it also possesses some medicinal value. Infusion is found effective in diabetes and diarrhea. The leaf juice is applied locally over the wasp or bee stings. When the extract of the roots and leaves are anti-carcinogenic. Next. Bale, or its botanical name is Agel marmelose. Now, the leaf decoction is used over fever. Now, unripe fruit is high in vitamin C, so it is used to prevent scurvy and used for chronic dysentery and diarrhea. Even the ripe fruit is aromatic and mildly laxative, and is extracted with water used for chronic constipation and dyspepsia, that is painful digestion. Next. Okay. Next is sitaphal, or the custard apple. Now some might not know that this plant possesses some medicinal property. Anemia. It is a anemia is nothing but a condition where the hemoglobin in the blood is quite low. The seed promotes vomiting, and this is good during food poisoning, as it helps in cleansing the stomach. And also the seed powder and mixed with alcohol and applied externally to hair is found to be good remedy for dandruff. Next. Patpanas, or in English is known as sour soap. We all know it as a cancer fruit. We heard that it fights the cancer, but how does it fight? It contains something known as phytochemicals. Now these are substances which is required for overall good health of the body. It has found having cytotoxic effect over multi-drug resistant cancer cells. Now, it fights the cancer through something known as cytotoxic effects, which kills the cancer cells. Now, cytotoxic effect is quite similar to the other medication which is used for cancer, that is radiation, chemotherapy, or other kind of medical practices which has been used for it. And not just it helps in it is a cancer fruit, but also it is found helpful in high blood pressure, heart diseases, and diabetes. Next. Okay, the next is kerbel, that is curry leaf. Now this curry leaf juice possesses weight loss potential, so it is extremely useful for obese type people who are very overweight. Its daily usage of tea with tea decoction with leaves is found very helpful. Leaves are also eaten raw for relieving the vomiting. Anyone is oil made from the leaves and seeds possesses antifungal and antibacterial properties. Its leaves are packed with multiple nutrients like carbohydrates, phosphorus, iron, multivitamins, and flavonoids. Next. Okay, Kefla or toothache tree. We usually use these fruit seeds actually to make our Indian curry in our household. But its bark decoction is taken to cure chest pain, and it is very useful in treating toothache, asthma, and dyspepsia. Bark powdered and mixed with oil is normally used externally as a remedy for a stomach pain. Next. Rumoured or a cluster fig. Now its root sap is used for treating diabetes. Both fruit and root is credited with hypoglycemic activity, that it is quite beneficial for those person with a diabetes. The stem bark is astringent and used in skin diseases, piles, etc. Useful for treating dysentery. Dysentery is nothing but a blood diarrhea. Next. Okay, so I have included this and the other plant also, which is going to be, just to make people aware there are some of the plants which are very toxic or maybe can be quite very poisonous, and you should be quite away from them. And there are some innocent children play with that and find themselves in a trouble. So adults should take a proper measures so that this plant is not messed up with, because it contains a poison known as abrin, and its botanical name is Abrin precatorius. It contains a poison abrin, and just 3 milligrams of it is enough to make a fatal dose to an adult. Now it is now one seed contains more than 3 milligrams, so it must be, you should be aware that even just chewing or having scratches with this what we call, even calling kokani kavlyache dole, it should be kept away from this plant. Children should be kept away from this plant. Even the seeds are used to make necklace. Okay, can you just go for previous slide? Yeah, just being so poisonous, it also have some oil this, since even it is poisonous, it has some medicinal properties. Like oil prepared from seed is highly used in Ayurveda to promote or stimulate hair growth. Next. This plant is known as Vagachi Nakta or flame lily. Its botanical name is Gloriosa superba. This plant is also extremely toxic. Every part of the plant is toxic, especially the tubers. It contains toxic alkaloid known as colchicine. It is also known as state flower Tamil Nadu, and decoction of tuber is used as a topical medicine. Means topical medicine is actually used when to apply it over a certain part of the body. Management in promoting labor pain. It is also used in treatment of piles. Now these crushed tubers are also used externally for neuralgic pains and skin troubles. This PPT was just to make you aware of some of the plants which might be considered as a weed and we throw away, or there may be some plants which are very toxic or poisonous. If you practice using some medicinal plants, or here I am positive thing to tell us about a medicinal plant, please share your experience after the end of this session.
Okay, thank you.
Thank you, Kushal. That was very informative presentation. Now, we have our second speaker, Mrs. Priyanka Mandip Naik, BSc at Bachelor College of and joint manager of Rasraj Goa Farms, based at Moisan Molem. She has been guest lecturer for different occasions. Apart from that, she has also been teacher of grade 1 teaching horticulture to pre-university students. Soon after graduation, she orally presented two research papers at an international conference of science in November 2019, anchored on urban gardening for CCR TV channel. She also been elected as treasurer for Botanical Society of Goa. Veteran for organizing plant preserve and conducting an all Goa home garden competition conducted at cut related demonstration in over 40 schools all over Goa. Founding president of the Agriculture Alumni Association Goa. And today she is going to cover on the topic Miracle Fertilizer Panchagavya preparation and uses. Yes, Priyanka, you can start.
Thank you, Shweta. Good evening, everyone. So today I'm going to cover on Panchagavya preparation uses in organic farming. Okay, so first of all, why do we need Panchagavya? Okay, so Panchagavya, when we look at organic agriculture practices, when someone wants to do their farms or cultivate their farms organically, the one remedy or one and only remedy is Panchagavya, because this is the decoction or the organic fertilizer which has ample of energy or ample of nutrients that helps the soil to enrich and also the plants to get boosted to improve its immunity, to promote the growing hormones in the plant, and it also makes the plant disease free. And there is also a high profit because you get impressive yields, and there is a lot of difference in your farm when you go organically by using organic fertilizers like Panchagavya. Next. So what is Panchagavya is? Okay.
Okay. So Panchagavya is a...
Panchagavya is an organic product which has the potential to promote the growth and immunity of the plant system. So how is Panchagavya prepared? So it is a decoction which is prepared by using the five major cow products, that is cow dung, cow urine,
cow milk, cow ghee, and cow milk. Along with that, there are other substitutes like jaggery, then banana, toddy, tender coconuts, which are added to the decoction to improve its efficacy. So when we mix all these almost 9 products together, we get something called as panchagavya, which has miraculous effect in agriculture. I'll show some of the demonstrations or some of the results in this PPT in the next slides. Okay, next slide, please. So the ingredients that we need for panchagavya are cow dung, as I told you, cow urine, cow ghee, cow milk, water, it has to be a clear water, clean water, cow curd, jaggery, tender coconut, and well ripened banana. So what's the quantity that requires is next. So one requires around 5 kg of cow dung. Next. So there are two formulas, that is, there we have Dr. K. Natarajan formula, which is developed by Dr. K. Natarajan, who is a physician by his profession, but accidentally he has found out this panchagavya, that is during Mahashivaratri, when the bharji has come to do his puja and he was offered panchagavya to drink. He refused it because it was excreta of the cow. So he used a little part of it and the rest was thrown out from his house. So what happened is in his entrance of the house, one side of the plants where he threw away the panchagavya, the plants were very well thriving and they show excellent results. Whereas the other side of the garden where there was no panchagavya which was thrown away, the plants were lagging behind in their growth. So he accidentally found that this panchagavya has a tremendous results when we apply it for a plant. So that's how he discovered it, panchagavya is beneficial for the plant growth. So what are the ingredients and how much we require to prepare at least 20 liters of panchagavya? So for a fresh cow dung, to prepare 20 liters of panchagavya, we require fresh cow dung, that is 5 kg. Then fresh cow urine, that is 3 liters. Then cow milk, 2 liters. Cow ghee, pure cow ghee, 500 grams, that is half a kilo. Jaggery, 500 grams. Water or sugarcane juice, 3 liters. Ripe banana fruit, 1 bunch. Tender coconut water, 3 liters. Coconut toddy, 2 liters. So how do we go about it? Next slide. First, we need to take a pot, which is either a mud pot or a plastic pot. We have to avoid anything that is metal or
that is going to react with the
content.
So we have to use a mud pot or a plastic drum. So for that, in that drum, we need to take 5 kg of this fresh cow dung and mix it with 500 grams of cow ghee. So when we mix this, both the contents, we need to mix them thoroughly by kneading it either with your hand or you can use a wooden ladle and mix it thoroughly for around 4 days. And you have to make sure that you stir the entire content for twice a day. That is once in the morning and once in the evening time. So once you have passed this, once you have completed your 4 days of mixing your cow dung and cow ghee, then you can add on the 5th day, you can add your cow urine, cow milk, cow's curd, and jaggery and sugarcane. So all the rest of the things can be added from the 5th day of the preparation. And the entire content has to be mixed twice a day, daily twice, so that there is aeration for all the microbes, all the beneficial microbes to grow. And that is very important that you stir the entire content twice a day, that is in the morning and the evening. And when you are going to add your bananas or the fruits, you have to make sure that they are stirred twice, they are mashed up properly and made into a puree before we are going to add it. Because when you are adding the contents which are finer in size, they get fermented very faster compared to if you are going to add the whole banana fruit. And it will take time to get fermented, so it's better if you add the purees, or even when you are going to add jaggery, it has to be grated so it can dissolve faster. Next.
Okay.
So this is how you can see in the first picture how you can mix your ghee and cow dung together and to mix it thoroughly. Next slide. Then you have to knead it in the cow. The ghee has to be kneaded with your hand or with the wooden ladle. Next slide. Then from the third day from the preparation, you can add your cow urine. And from the fifth day, you can add the rest of the contents like your sugarcane juice, then banana, curd, cow milk, all the rest of the contents has to be added. Next slide. Now, because when you're going for a commercial production, is laboristic. So it takes a lot of your time to, you know, especially go and open the drum and stir it twice. So there are aerating micro pneumatic pump for stirring your drums, which contains the panchagavya. So you can do it mechanically if you're going for a commercial production, wherein you can use a mechanical pneumatic pump to aerate the drum, or you can use a ladder or a stick to stir the entire content. Another important factor that you need to remember when you're honest, you need to close the drum with a jute sack or a plastic bag once you are done with mixing of the contents. Because if you leave the drum open after adding all the contents, the there'll be fruit flies or house flies which will come and lay their eggs into the cow dung. So to avoid that, we need to close the drum tightly so that there is no entry of any house fly and we won't have any maggots infesting into our panchagavya preparation, the entire decoction. Yeah. Next slide. So what are the important contents? What do we find in panchagavya when we why we do panchagavya is, you can see the entire range of nutrients that are present into the panchagavya itself. So you have macronutrients, that is your nitrogen, phosphorus, potassium, which is also available in panchagavya. Along with that, micronutrients. So majorly when we are going for a fertilizer application, we add micronutrients separately than macronutrients. Like for nitrogen, phosphorus, potassium, we need to add the fertilizers separately.
Look at the organic decoction like panchagavya, which has both the nutrients like your macro ones
and micro together. And along with that, we have many beneficial contents like proteins, fats, carbohydrates, beneficial microorganisms, fungi, enzymes, then growth promoting hormones, which are essential for the plant to improve upon its immunity and to fight back to the disease causing organisms. So you can see how important it can be in the agriculture field if we use the panchagavya commercially for our farm based activities. Next. Next slide. Yeah, okay. So these are the beneficial microorganisms which you find in panchagavya, like beneficial fungi. These are their colony forming units in per ml solution. So in 1 ml of solution, you'll find this fungi colonies of around 38,000. Then lactobacillus bacteria and other beneficial anaerobes which are essential for the plant growth. Next slide. Okay, now when we are going to look for a quality of the panchagavya, so it all depends on cow, right? It all depends on cow products. So when we are going to select or take out or use the cow products like cow dung, which is the most important factor in the panchagavya, then cow urine, we need to go for a breed which is indigenous or which is local, because these are the breeds which are away from this harmful antibiotics, or they are not injected with antibiotics and they are purely organic. So we need to select the breed which is indigenous, like a daisy cow, like boss indica, which we call for local Indian cows. And we need to select their cow dung, because they are organic in nature and they don't go for any kind of injections, or they are not injected with steroids. So their cow dung is much more organic in nature, and the microbial count that we are looking at will be much more better than the Holstein Friesian or Jersey, which are injected with antibiotics or steroids for their better beef production or better milk production. Next slide. Okay, so we have to avoid the usage of products which are coming from Jerseys or Holstein Friesian. So that's the important factor of panchagavya. Next slide. Now, how do we apply panchagavya? Once we know how easy the panchagavya procedure is, now what is the perfect dose that one needs to follow when they are going to apply it into the field? So panchagavya works best when you apply 3% solution. That is, you need to dilute this concentrated panchagavya when we prepare 20 liters. Out of that, we need to just take 30 ml per liter of water and dilute in that 1 liter of water, and we need to use it for a foliar spray or soil wrenching. So that is important when you're going for a application. You need to use 3% solution, that is 30 ml per liter of water. So another important factor is, because we are going to use a sprayer, panchagavya has of course a powder of cow dung. So we have to stain the panchagavya thoroughly at least twice if you are using a broad whole sieve. So you have to sieve it twice so that you stain all the coarse material from it. And when you are going to spray it with a sprayer, your nozzles are not clogged by the cow dung sediments. So you have to make sure that you sieve the panchagavya before you are going to spray it. Next. So how you can use it? One can go for a foliar spray, that is 3% solution. You can use for a foliar spray for your vegetables, fruits. You can use for all the plants. Panchagavya can be used for all the plants, from your fruiting trees to your cultivation trees, plants to your paddy. Okay. So from medicinal plants to plantation plants, you can use it to all the kinds of cultivation crops. Then you can go for a seedling treatment or for seed storage. So seedling treatment is when you're going to transplant the seedling, that is, for example, chili, brinjals, tomatoes. If you are you have prepared a nursery and you're going to transplant it to the main field, to avoid any kind of disease attack or to avoid any kind of wilt which may occur to the seedling when you're going to transplant it to the new field, to avoid such kind of problems, you can go for a seedling treatment. You can use 30 ml or per liter of panchagavya and use that diluted panchagavya to do the seedling treatment. That will encourage the plant growth, becoming hormones which are beneficial for the plant growth. So you can also go for seedling treatment. Then soil wrenching. For soil wrenching also, you can mix your panchagavya in water, and around the root zone of the plant, you can just pour it over there. Then in fertigation. Fertigation is when you put the panchagavya in your irrigation tank or the irrigation channel and supply the panchagavya along with the irrigation water. That is what fertigation is. So if you're supplying your panchagavya dose along with the irrigation water, that is fertigation. Next. So as I told you, panchagavya can be used for all crops. So for crops which are hardy, okay, which are bigger in size and which have broad leaves, you can go for a 3% solution of panchagarbha, that is 30 ml per liter of water. And crops like which have delicate leaves, like snake gourd or cucumbers, mint, bottle gourds. So for that, you can use 2% solution, that is 20 ml per liter of water. So that's the dose. Next. So they make a trench in between the two coconut trees, and in that trench they add all the farmyard waste, and on top of that, once it gets degraded, you can spray the panchagavya and leave your earthworms. After 15 days of spraying panchagavya, then you can leave the earthworms over it. Yes, next slide. So what are the periodicity of application of panchagavya? So for fruiting trees, you can go in three stages, that is pre-flowering stage, that is 20 days after planting, when you're going to plant a seedling, you can take a spray of panchagavya once in 15 days. Okay, you can take two sprays depending on the duration of crop. Then at flowering and pot setting stage, you can take the spray once in 10 days. Then in once the pots have formed, at pot maturity stage, you can take panchagavya spray once during a pod maturation stage. So once the pod is maturing, that time you can take one time spray of panchagavya. Now with the crops like paddy or cereals or and all seeds, you have to take the panchagavya spray at least 15 days interval, because they are grown on a large field. So because of flood irrigation, your panchagavya may get washed off with the water. So you can take the spray at least 15 days interval. And for vegetables and flowers, you can take your panchagavya spray once every week to get good bloom for your plants. Next slide. So where are the general effects? Next slide. So you can see the general effects of panchagavya on leaves, stem, roots, harvest. So overall, the growth of the plant can be boosted if we go for a panchagavya spray. Next slide. So when you look at the leaf area index, okay, so when we go for a panchagavya spray, since it has a plant growing hormones, plant growth promoting hormones, so these growth hormones boost the plant with growing factors. So this panchagavya, when we spray on the foliage of the plant, you can see there is a huge difference in the plant. Okay, there the foliage will become bigger in size, there will be more number of leaves which will come onto the plant, and that will increase the total leaf area surface for photosynthesis production. So if there is more of photosynthesis production, the plant has enough of energy to produce more flowers and more fruits. So that's how it is beneficial when you are looking at the yield perspective when the panchagavya is sprayed on the foliage application. Next, you can see the panchagavya effect on stems. So when we spray the panchagavya on stem also, for example, in sugarcane, the girth of the sugarcane will increase. Also, the height of the sugarcane will increase. When you're looking at the brinjal or tomatoes, they'll become more sturdy. That is, there'll be thickness in the stem. Then there'll be more height, and there'll be more weight for the fruits. So that's how you can see there is a wide difference in panchagavya when you're looking at the growth perspective of the plant. Next, we have I myself have even conducted a field research with panchagavya and EM, that is effective microorganism. We have taken the two. I have myself taken the two perspective, that is root nodule formation and leaf area index, and the height and weight of the plant, that is fresh weight and the dry weight of the mung bean, that is I have considered the vigna radiata, that is mung. And in my experiment, I have done two plots, four treatments, that is one plot I have grown mung plants without any treatment. In one plot, I have used only EM as a seed treatment and soil application, and one treatment. The third treatment was panchagavya, and the fourth treatment was panchagavya plus EM. So when I compared the results for fresh weight and the dry weight of the plant, when I treated them with Panchagavya and EM, I found out that the plant which were treated with Panchagavya had larger leaves, leaf area was increased, the root nodule formation, because mung is a legume plant, so it has nodule formation. So even the nodule formation was better compared to the other treatments. So I could see there was increase in number of nodule formation. There was increase in the plant height. There was increase in the flower formation. So that was my result wherein this experiment I had presented for a science. And I got very much better results when compared to the other treatments. So Panchagavya has given me good results when it was treated in the field. So when you're looking at the root formation, it also helps to give a better root which can go into the deep into the soil and it can take maximum of nutrients. Next. Then you can see its effect in vegetable also. When you are going to spray Panchagavya at every 15-day interval, you can see there is increment or enhancement in your yield by 20%. Your cucumber yield itself will get doubled. That is all your cucurbits. If you go for a Panchagavya spray, you can increase your yield. Then appearance of the vegetable will also much more glossy and appealing. Then TSS, that is total soluble solids, will be increased. Even the shelf life of the vegetable will be increased if you go for a Panchagavya spray. And the flavor of the fruit, that is your vegetable or fruit, will also be much more tastier when you compare to the normal cultivation. Next. Now, Panchagavya also helps in drought hardiness. What is drought hardiness is? Because when we prepare Panchagavya, we add cow ghee, right? Then cow curd, which is oily in nature. So what happens is Panchagavya has that oil content into it when we prepare Panchagavya. So when we go for a foliar spray, what happens is this Panchagavya, due to its oily substance in the solution, it forms a oily coating over the leaf surface. So the entire leaf gets covered with the oily peel, so that avoids the evaporation loss of water from the plant. So what happens is during summer when the plant transpires more, that is it evaporates water from its body, that water is stored by reducing the evaporation loss of water. So we can reduce the water application during summer season because the plant gets more hardiness due to formation of oily layer on the top of the leaf, so that subsides the use of water. Next. Then you can see application of this Panchagavya on mango. So when we apply this 33% solution of Panchagavya as a foliar spray on mango, you'll see there is dense flowering and you'll get more of a female flowers on the mango tree. And also, if your mango tree is bearing once in a year or it is alternate bearer, then you can even change that kind of tree to a regular bearer, because Panchagavya induces those fruiting hormones into the plant. And it also enhances the keeping quality by 12 days at room temperature. Even the flavor and the aroma of the fruit can be enhanced if you go for a Panchagavya spray in mango cultivation. Next. Then you look at the lime, is the total soluble solids and the big content, that is the sweetness of the fruit will also increase, and the shelf life will also increase by 5 days if you compare the normal guava along with the Panchagavya treated guava. You'll see there is a lot of difference and it will be much more tastier. Next we have banana. So sometimes we see when a banana grow normally, so when we have a bunch which is coming out from a banana plant, the bunch which has the banana at the banana bunch which is at topmost level, that is at the first bunch, will be larger in size. The banana fingers will be bigger in size compared to the lower ones. So because once the navel flower, the flower which is here, falls down, what happens is there is not enough of energy for the lower bananas to take in, and that's why they remain smaller in size. So if you want the entire bunch to be in same size and they, all the bananas to have same size and same, you know, the bunch to look similar throughout the entire bunch, then you can go for Panchagavya treatment. That what we have to do is, we have to remove the flower, the bun, this flower which is attached to the bunch, and through that we have to tie a bag which is containing 3% solution of Panchagavya. That is, we dilute the 30 ml of Panchagavya in 1 liter of water, and out of that diluted solution, you have to take 100 ml in a polythene bag, in a packaging bag, and you can tie it to the end part. After cutting the flower, the end portion, you can tie it with the Panchagavya and leave it till it gets mature. So once the entire bunch gets mature, you'll see there is a lot of difference. That is, your entire bunch will be similar in size, and even the shelf life of the banana will be increased if you go for Panchagavya solution tied at the navel end. So that is its importance in banana cultivation. Next. Next is turmeric. So even in turmeric cultivation, you can go for a foliar spray, or you can go for a rhizome dip. When you're going to put your rhizome into the soil, you can dip the rhizome before sowing them into the soil in a 3% solution of Panchagavya, or you can go for a foliar spray. That will increase your yield by 22%. Then you will have larger fingers. That is, the when you go for a Panchagavya spray, the fingers, that is the rhizome which is there in the soil, will increase in size, will be longer. Then you also get rid of all the pests which are getting affected by all the pests that attacks the turmeric. They will also go away with the smell of Panchagavya. It will also enhances the curcumin content, that is the active compound which is found into the turmeric. So curcumin content will also better, and which is beneficial if you are going for a pharmaceutical company to sell your turmeric, because they look at the curcumin content. Next. Okay. So for flowering plants, you can see that is when you go for a Panchagavya spray, there will be exceptional aroma and fragrance. For example, in jasmine, rose. If you are going for a Panchagavya spray, you can increase their flowering efficacy. Even for orchid, if the orchid is not flowering, then you can go for a Panchagavya spray. When you when you see your flowering plant not giving you enough flowers, or it's not giving you enough of, you know, profuse flowering, you can go Panchagavya spray, 3% Panchagavya spray. So that's in flowering context. Next.
Then in vegetables.
So overall vegetable, if you are going for a vegetable plot, which is want to add all data chemicals, Panchagavya is the best solution, wherein you can just use Panchagavya without adding anything else. You can just spray your Panchagavya every 15-day interval, and you'll see tremendous results. That your fruit will be much more tastier, will get double the yield than the normal fertilizers. Then you have more glossy appearance on the vegetable, and they'll be much more tastier, and there'll be more strong flavors to your food. So that's how vegetables can be cultivated with Panchagavya. You know, just need to spray it just 15 days interval, so that they the efficacy is more prominent in the soil. Next.
Then paddy, this research was
then paddy and her guru for a rave, and it was also tried by us. We are staying in the villages, and we get the farmers to get better yield and get the knowledge from technical perspective. So in that, what we have done is we have treated our paddy seedling with the Panchagavya, and we tried to sow it with SRM method. we have kept at least 20 centimeter distance between the two plants. And there was a good tillering, that is, there was heavy tillering. You can see the spikes have increased when we have gone for the wet spray. There were no chaffy grains. Then the percentage of rice broken was also reduced. And there is, you can harvest your paddy 15 days earlier if you go for a panchagavya spray. For this paddy also, you have to spray your panchagavya at 15 days intervals to get the tremendous results in your field. You can see El Panchagavya has wide results with respect to the paddy cultivation. And that's how we need it for, you know, paddy is our staple food. So if you go with organic substitutes like Panchagavya, then we can have a good result in our field. Next. Even sugarcane is widely cultivated in most of the southern parts of Goa. So even you can spray Panchagavya, or you can go for a fertigation, that is your irrigation water. You can add your Panchagavya and you'll see the result for your sugarcane. You'll have a longer length for the canes, and even the girth of the sugarcane will be much more better. Next. Then for coconut, you can see coconut crop which requires ample of nutrients for its growth. Okay, so when you look at the growth and when you look at the amount of fertilizers that we need for a coconut, then even in coconut production, if you go for a Panchagavya spray, that is, if you go for a soil drenching with Panchagavya, then you will have the size of the nuts that is increased. Even the thickness and the weight of the kernel will be, and you will have 30% increase in your kernel. So you'll have a good copra content for your coconuts, and the overall plant will be much more healthier. You can even go for a root treatment. That is, you can select one mature root and dilute the concentrated Panchagavya, that is 30 ml per liter, 3% solution, and you can tie it to the root. So you can go take a selected root at least 1.5 meter away from the trunk, and there where that is where the breeding roots of the coconut thrives. So over there you can dig a peat of 30 centimeter depth, and there you can select a coconut root, and to that root you can tie Panchagavya. So it gives you results faster than the soil application. Next. So you can see how profusely the papaya cultivation can be done if you go for a Panchagavya foliar spray or even with a soil application. And that's how a jackfruit tree is fruiting when they have given a foliar spray with Panchagavya and even the soil drenching. Next. So Panchagavya is also beneficial for animal consumption when you take it or when you consume it in a smaller quantities, that is, you have to just dilute this 50 ml of Panchagavya, diluted Panchagavya, liter of water, and that water you can drink in early in the morning to get a cure with most of the skin disorders or other ailments like diabetes and all. And for example, when you are going for a animal husbandry, like you have cows, piggery, then goats, fishery production, then even if you feed your animals with Panchagavya or diluted concentration of Panchagavya, the animals will be much more healthier, and you can keep them away from all the disease-causing organisms, and even their health can be maintained, and their body ratio, that is the body mass index, can also be increased when looking at the meat production. So that's how you can use Panchagavya for animals. That's next. So this is how a mode of action for animals, that you can stimulate the immune system of animal. Then it produces antibodies against the ingested microorganisms, and it also acts as a vaccine when you ingest the Panchagavya in animals. Then it improves the appetite, your digestion, the assimilation and elimination of all the toxins from the body. Thus the animals become more healthy and shining with your good weight gain. So those are the impressive results you can see in animals when you're looking at the Panchagavya feeding. Next.
So how
So how long you can stay, keep your panchagavya or the the quality of the panchagavya can be retained. So you can store your panchagavya once you have prepared it for at least 6 months to without any deterioration in the quality. So if you find in the period of 6 months, if you find your panchagavya has become thick and it has dried up, then you can add cow urine, or you can add a clean water along with cow urine and stir it nicely. So that won't deteriorate any quality of your panchagavya. So you can keep your panchagavya for 6 months. And important factor is to stir it morning and evening twice a day. So that is important to keep the microbes active in the solution. Yeah. Next. Thank you. That's it.
Thank you, Priyanka. That was a wonderful session. Now, we have our third speaker, Ms. Liza Finero. She completed BSc degree in agriculture at Don Bosco College of Agriculture, Kolkata. Founder of Kitchen Gardening and Plant Health Consultancy called Fruits of Hard Work, conducted webinars and trainings on kitchen gardening, composting, pest and pest management, and other agricultural activities for schools, for farmers, and gardeners. She does consultations on setting up organic kitchen gardens and orchards, composting, beekeeping, planting, and manuring trees, mushroom cultivation, and plant pest and disease management. So, today she is going to cover on the topic management of fungal disease of plants in mushroom. Yes, Lisa, you can start.
Thank you so much, Shweta. Good evening, everyone. So today I'll be discussing about some fungal disease management in monsoon season. Next slide. Yeah, so monsoon is a time when you see different types of mushrooms popping up. Like I've listed some examples. There is plant pod dappelings, there's parasol mushrooms, you'll see common bonnets and agaricus mushroom, then there will be puff balls, you'll see some slime molds too. But when you see these mushrooms, in the previous slide, yeah. So when you see these mushrooms, you need to be happy because these are really good fungi and they help in degrading the organic matter in the soil. So yes, all mushrooms are fungi and these are good ones. Now we'll see some bad fungi which cause diseases in monsoon. Next slide, please. So the reasons for disease causing fungi is mainly water stagnation. Like for example, in the first picture, you can see the pot is overly filled with water. This happens when you keep pot outside in the rain for prolonged hours. And if there's no proper drainage, it will start filling with water. And then it invites a lot of fungal pathogens to attack your healthy plants. Sometimes your seedlings might rot and even seeds will start rotting. In the second picture, you can see the soil is too wet and poorly drained. It is important that you maintain or improve the soil porosity by preparing raised beds, or you can add cocopate or leaves or rice husk to improve the porosity and drainage in this soil. Now, another reason is fluctuations in temperature. Like for example, last week it was continuously pouring and today it was quite dry. So you can feel the increase in humidity. So when there's sudden increase in humidity or there's sudden decrease in humidity, the fungal pathogens get a chance to attack and grow in this moist and damp environment. So these are some of the precautions which you can take if you're growing in containers or if you're growing on land. That is to prepare raised beds to sow vegetable seeds during monsoon, and to add cocopate or dry leaves or rice husk in the soil mixture to improve the porosity. Also make sure that your pot has drainage holes to save water which gets filled in the monsoon. Next slide. Now we'll see some of the fungal diseases in ornamental plants. The first one is blight in begonia. Now begonias are more prone to blight or root rots in monsoon. The edges of the leaves will start burning. You will see it's like it has got some burnt like appearance. Now this happens when it's in the rain. Begonias do not love when the velvety leaf surface comes in contact with water. That's why it's important to water it in the root and not on the leaves. The second one is root rot in fiddle fig. Now root rot is common in many other indoor ornamental plants like snake plant or philodendron, pothos, caladiums. Now what is the sign of root rot? The first sign is the green leaves will start drooping and the lower leaves will start yellowing and they will be very weak and not very firm and will be very weak and flexible kind of thing. Now to prevent root rot, you need to have proper drainage and also make sure that you do not overwater. In monsoon, you need to check your pots by dabbing your thumb into the pots, into the soil. If it is moist enough, it does not require water. If it is dry, then water it. Then the third commonly found disease in orchid is black rot. The leaves of the orchid starts turning black and after some days, the whole orchid dies. Now this happens when there's too much of water in the orchid mix or when it is kept in the rain for too long or the log in which you have mounted orchid is too wet. So this, when there's too much of moistness and dampness, it invites a lot of fungal diseases, which fungal pathogens which will cause diseases in these ornamental plants. Next slide. Previous slide. Next slide. Now how to manage? Now we say that monsoon is the best time for repotting. So when you're repotting, just make sure that you choose healthy potting mix, not the same old one. If you're using the same old one, it's better if you treat it with trichoderma. I will come back to trichoderma very soon. You need to change the potting mix and repot the plant if it has overgrown. When it has overgrown, you can separate out if it has got some pups and you can repot it in a bigger pot. Then second step is you can clip off the infected leaf. If there's one infected leaf which has turned yellow or it has gone some brown color margins, then you can clip it off and add trichoderma at the rate of 10 ml per liter of water. So instead of watering that day, you can dilute trichoderma in 1 liter of water and pour it in the pots. Also, you need to make sure that the infected plant should be kept away from the healthy plant, because otherwise this spores from the infected pot will disseminate into the healthy pots and will start infecting all the healthy ones too. So if you see your indoor plants or your garden plants in pots infected by the diseases, it's better to keep them away from the healthy ones to prevent infection. Now in the third picture, I have listed a bottle which is Nisarg. It is actually a good fungus called as Trichoderma viridae, which is used in organic agriculture to treat all the bad fungi. There are two companies in Goa which are selling, which will usually find Trichoderma, that is Nisarg or BioCure F. So you can purchase it and use it for all ornamentals to tackle all these soil-borne fungal diseases. Next slide. Now we'll see some fungal diseases in flowering ornamentals. The first example is black spots of rose. You'll see some tiny black spots on rose leaves and eventually it will cover the entire leaf and you'll see defoliation. So this is also a fungal disease which you usually see in the monsoon season. If you don't treat it, it will prevail even in the next season. The second one is powdery mildew of gerbera. Now, powdery mildew is seen in gerbera, dahlia, chrysanthemum, velvety textured leaves. So it's like you have dusted flower on the leaves, and in case of severe infestation, the plant will look like it's completely dusted with flower and will turn white, and eventually it will wilt and die. The third one on my lower left is botrytis blight of rose. Now this starts in monsoon. Instead of getting a good bloom, you'll see the rose is getting brown color or it's having burnt appearance. Sometimes you'll see molasses. In severe, see gray color fungus growing on the roses or even on the buds, or sometimes the plant looks weak. So So in this case, you need to clip off the roses, clip off the leaves which has got infected, and then spray Pseudomonas fluorescens at the rate of 10 ml per liter of water on the entire plant. Soon after clipping, you have to spray Pseudomonas on the entire plant. Now, Pseudomonas fluorescens is a good bacteria. It's found in nature, but because of some pollution or soil degradation, it has died. So that's the time when you need to introduce these bacteria back on your plants by spraying at the rate of 10 ml per liter of water. This will suppress the fungal growth. Now, Pseudomonas fluorescens is available as Persia or Biofewer B in agriculture stores. So next slide. Now we'll see some fungal diseases attacking vegetables, fruits and spices in monsoon. The first one is damping off of brinjal. When you're raising seedlings for transplanting in case of brinjals or fenugreek and even okra, that's ladyfinger, you'll see the collar region of the stem is wilting and rotting, and after some time the entire plant, the entire seedling will fall off. So in the first picture you can see there's a patch which has fallen all over, so that is damping off disease. And after a few days, the entire nursery or entire seedlings will, 2 hours you can do your spraying, because Pseudomonas is a bacteria which multiplies within 20 minutes. So even if it gets 2 hours or 3 hours per a dry day, it will start showing its effectivity. Yes. Now these two are very common disease seen in coconut and arachnid plantation in monsoon. The first one is choleroga of arachnid. Instead of getting green and orange arachnids, you will see them coated with white color fungus or gray color fungus, and you will see premature nut fall around the root zone of the arachnids. So this is a disease called choleroga of arachnid. In severe infestation, when the entire arachnid plantation is infested, you will get very poor quality arachnids. Sometimes it will be empty inside. So you need to remove these infected arachnids and start spraying. And there's another common fungal disease in coconut, that is bud rot. Now the name has given, the bud starts rotting. So in the first picture it's a sapling. The main bud, sometimes people call it as needle, has turned brown. If it's neglected or if it's not treated, the entire sapling will turn brown and start drooping leaves, like in the second picture. That's a big tree which has got infestation. If you see a coconut tree with bud rot, it is important to chop off the tree and treat the entire coconut plantation with Pseudomonas fluorescens. Now you'll be wondering how to spray on such tall trees. Next picture. So to spray on trees like arachnid or coconut, there are special sprayers. One is rocker sprayer, because many Goans have huge arachnid and coconut plantations, so it's better if you invest either in rocker sprayer or power sprayer to tackle these diseases which are mostly seen in monsoon. The price range for rocker spray is 5,000 to 8,000. You can inquire in your zonal agriculture offices about the prices and the incentives given on different sprayers and machineries. Now this sprayer is manually operated. There's one person pedaling it to generate pressure and pump. And the other one is spraying on the canopy of the tree. If it's a coconut plucker can take the hose and take it on the crown of the arachnid tree or a coconut tree and do the spraying. The other one is which has more pressures compared to rocker sprayer is power sprayer. Now this is run on fuel. The price range is between 10,000 to 25,000. The good qualities are also 30 to 40,000 too. And it has very long hose. So you can take it, it is portable, and you can spray it on the entire plant. You can take it up on the coconut tree and do the spraying. So this was, so these are two types of sprayers meant for spraying for tall trees. So this was all for today. If you have queries, you can ask me by turning on the mic, or you can type it in the chat box. Thank you so much. I also do consultations for setting up kitchen gardening and plant health. You can contact me through Fruits of Hard Work on Facebook and Instagram. Yeah, thank you.
Thank you, Lisa. That was very informative session. So, any questions?
Hello? Yeah, where you get all these medicines? You have just... Yeah, hello, ma'am. Where are you based? Yes, hello, ma'am. Gauri. In Panjim, you'll get it at NV Eco Farm office, which is in Tonka. You can type on Google NV Eco Farm office. You'll get their contact number. You'll get all kind of biopesticides over there, Trichoderma, then Sparsha, and even Pseudomonas. And Baba too.
I can get it in at Mapta yard. You know, there is a Goa Bagaida Society. They have it.
Samika, would you like to answer this?
Yeah, the Goa Bagaidar Society in Mapsa unfortunately doesn't stock it, neither in Margao. If someone is Polda upper market, you can get it with Goa Bagaidar. They do have, but you don't have in Mapsa. The closest
so I get it from Tonka,
from Tonka okay. is to buy TV.
Okay, thank you.
You're welcome.
I have a question. If Panchagavya is used, do we still need to use Sparsha? Panchagavya is used. Do we still need to use Sparsha and stuff like that? Thank you.
Yeah, Panchagavya is more kind of Chyavanprash. When you spray Panchagavya or spore Panchagavya in for your plants, it boosts plants' immunity. So even for disease infestation, the yield will not get affected. So that's the power of Panchagavya, because it contains five different products along with tender coconut and bananas and jaggery too. So it's
Shweta, I think you can wind up.
Okay, thank you very much for all the information.
Lisa, I think Shweta has gone off. Lisa, could you conclude? Shweta's lost connection.
Yes, sir. Yeah, thank you so much, participants, for joining our webinar. I would also like to thank Sir Miguel for mentoring us and guiding us to conduct this very informative webinar. Then I would like to thank the Botanical Society of Goa for giving us opportunity to conduct free webinars. We have completed 33 webinars till date, started last year. And today I would like to specially thank Andrea Cheradil. She has played a very good part for doing a favor by presenting us from Maharashtra, because we have very poor internet connectivity today. Well, thank you.